Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. It's August 18th, believe it or not, 2016, and I would like to call today's Sports Authority Board of Directors meeting to order. We are in the Patron Platinum Club today. It's a beautiful space at Bridgestone Arena. We really appreciate the Predators and their organization for hosting us. And we had a good showing today, obviously. It's hard to get folks seated, so that's a good sign. Thank you all for attending. We will begin our agenda with our first item as far as reviewing the minutes from our July 21st meeting. They were sent to the board on Friday. Are there any questions or revisions for the meeting minutes? Is there a motion? Thank you.
Second.
We have a motion and a second for approval of our meeting minutes. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. The minutes are approved. At this time, we'll hear our executive director's report from Monica Faulknessen.
Thank you for being here today. The agenda is before you. In addition to our monthly facility reports, there's just a couple of items I wanted to point out. Is that better? Is that better?
Yes.
Okay. let's see, let's start with item number 6, which is the approval of this year's CMA parking settlement summary. And I'll talk more about this a little bit later, but this is something that will require action by the board. Also, item number 7, the Populous facility study update. So in February, when we were at Ford Eye Center, I think you'll remember that Adam Stover and Sean Henry gave a brief presentation. And they basically they reminded us that, believe it or not, Bridgestone Arena is almost 20 years old. And in light of that, it's time to start planning for the next 20 or even 30 years. So this morning, they're going to really just share and present some possibilities. I think you're going to find those very interesting as we look to the future of the arena. Are there any questions about the agenda before I move forward? Okay, well, my report is very brief. The electric vehicles at Nissan Stadium that we have talked about over the last couple of months are live. Nissan right now is just starting to kind of wrap up the branding, the wrapping, the design that we spoke about at the last meeting, and they expect for that to be completed by September 11th, the Titans' home opener. And then internally, they're also working on a ribbon cutting, so as we get more details on that, we will we'll let you know. I think that's something that never happened with the Chargers on Woodland, but I think it's really important, so we'll keep you up to date on that. We continue to work with Baker Donaldson on the contract for Verizon Wireless. Margaret Darby sent a draft over to them about 3 weeks ago, and my understanding is that they are reviewing that. They're also working to provide the structural analysis on the spire that we have spoken about. And so right now the ball is in their court, and so we're waiting to hear back from them. And as we do, we will definitely keep you apprised. Finally, I'd like to thank Alicia. Alicia, over the last several months, has spent an inordinate amount of time combing through files and documents that date back to day one of the Sports Authority, really. And she's been organizing them, bringing them to me to review, you know, all with the purpose of preparing to send them to Metro Archives. And as you can imagine, it's been a very lengthy and a very detailed process. But about 2 weeks ago, they came and picked up 14 boxes that are now with the Metro Archives. She has had multiple conversations with the Metro Records Management Group, and they are recommending that archive documents pertaining to our facilities be retained for the life of the building or until 3 years after the building is sold. So this new schedule will go to the Public Records Commission and will need to be approved by the commission this fall. And Alicia probably now knows more about the Sports Authority than just about anybody in this building after reading so much. But I wanted to say thank you because that was a big project and we're thankful for that. If there are no questions, that concludes my report.
Thank you, Monica, and thank you, Alicia. We appreciate all the hard work that you are doing and continue to do for the Sports Authority Board. Next up, we have Larry Adama, who's back with us today to give us an update on the Nissan Stadium project.
Well, good morning. Thank you. We have an update, and what I'd like to do this morning is kind of start really big and get to real little toward the end of it. So we will start. The big picture headline would be we have less than 2,500 seats to go in replacement, and so I think we're in pretty good shape. We have had this extraordinary relationship with the Titans to get to accomplish that. We've got another giant inspection tomorrow of seats, which we use, you might find interesting, Tennessee State University engineering students to help us with. So whole army is going to go in there and check seats. And when we find problems, we fix them. Last week and several of the other events that have been and are coming, we have a team from the contractor group that is there. So if anything pops up as it did, that's not quite right with their seat, we jump on it and we fix it. And Bob has done a great job coordinating that. So just a little bit of facts in the background. There's some shots of the finished seats with the exception of some lower west side sections, but we're working through those. I think we'll be in good shape by the first regular game, which was our plan A, as you recalled, and we had a plan B that if we took a little bit longer, we would get that. So what I'd like to do is just hit a couple of headlines in terms of the budget. And I think you've already had these in your package. Remember that our budget and expenditures lag about 30 to 45 days. But we've spent about $10.5 million of the 15. We've got $4.5 to go. The details are there, but the headline would be we're about $1.5 million underspent right now in contingencies and other allowances and other categories we set aside in the budget. I'm going to come back to that $1.5 million at the end here and share a couple of things that we have uncovered. Just a couple of quick slides. One in DBE spending, small women owned and minority participation on this project is a little over 25%. The exact percentages by category are listed there. They're not quite where I usually like them, but the kind of project that this is harder to find some of the traditional construction trades that we use for those categories. But the good news and the big headline would be we're a little 26 or so percent small women-owned and minority business participation in this project, which is always good. Flipping to a couple of photographs, just to give you a little bit of headline. Come on back one, Ed. There you go. So if you recall on the phase one project, which we refer to as sort of the upper decks, we've repaired a whole bunch of expansion joints, replaced a lot of sealants, which you see there, and fixed a mountain of concrete and other improvements that really addressed all the water penetration issues into the facility. So going to the next slide, Ed, this would be my construction taking a little liberty. You see the column there on the left? Now, that looks just like a regular column, but it is a massively repaired column. It had a lot of deterioration in it, and so we're kind of proud of that because it looks like a regular column. That's what it should do. So anyway, I'm shameless about that. And then there's just a shot of the stairs, all the new stairs that we replaced and painted and put new guardrails and all that sort of thing. So just kind of a little snapshot into the facts there. Back to phase one. Like I said, we're just about done with all the replacement of seats. We've made up on the upper deck a mountain of concrete repairs, expansion joints replaced, cover plates installed, ceilings taken out, new floors and restrooms and concession stands. And we have just about completed all the punch lists and commissioning. As I alluded to earlier, we got students lined up for tomorrow at 7:30 with all of our team, and they'll be in there doing the final checks of what we've accomplished to date. Now, what happens in most renovation projects is when you start to dissect them and you get in there, you start to find more, and we have found more things that need to be addressed. particularly on the club level and some on level one. I think the way I would explain it would be on the upper decks, the amount of deterioration in the things that control water were pretty obvious and a lot more able to see them. As we started to remove seats on the mid-level decks and the lower decks and started to look a little bit closer, we started to find that there was more deterioration in the expansion joints and some of the sealants than we had expected or anticipated. Now that's the bad news. The good news is, referring back, we still have $1.5 million in the bucket. So we have met extensively with the Titans organization, with Monica, with Metro Finance, and my recommendation has been that while we've got this crew of very specialized contractors and a very specialized engineering firm there, let's go in and dissect this problem a little further. Now, we knew where some of the issues were because Bob gets leak reports from fans and those kinds of things. But in the upper right-hand corner, there's an example. We took the cover off of a joint after the seat was removed. That's what we found. And so there's a fair amount of that. So what we are recommending and have teed up to do is to re-engage the engineers to take a hard look at the club level now and the first level, and as we have been pulling things out, we know where problems are, we've tagged them, and to create a pecking priority list for us in A, most important, B, second, third, C, that if we don't catch them now, we know where they are and we can catch them, and we're designing an overall fix, which is about the same of what we've done on the upper levels. And then we're sitting down right now as we're settling up the first phase, we've got allowances and contingencies, as I think I shared earlier, we tend to build a lot of those in. We've got credits and expenses with subcontractors and so forth, but we think we're to the north of $1,500,000 in unspent funds. My recommendation this morning is that we continue on and try to fix as much of these water issues as we can, partly because this is a very specialized group of contractors and engineers. We've kind of learned how to do it. Titans have learned how to live with us. And so that's kind of the good news is we got some money to spend on it. The bad news, we got to do a little bit more work. And I would be delighted to take some questions. I didn't do that good a job, I know.
Well, you did a good job, but I'm just curious, the amount of the work that you've identified, will the $1.5 million unspent and your contingency funds cover that work?
I think it's going to certainly take probably all of it. Mm-hmm. We're doing some best guessing right now because we haven't got actual quantities of what we got to fix, but mm-hmm. I looked at Jordan the other day and I said, what's your gut? Mm-hmm. He said, probably most of it. And I said, that's about mine, too. But we will make that more definitive before the next meeting mm-hmm. yeah. and keep reporting that.
What's the time frame for completing that work, you think?
This fall. It'll be. We need another 2 to 3 or 4 weeks to get the engineers reengaged and back in. We've just gone mm-hmm. over their contract and the contract extension for them. We're sitting down with the subs right now that are starting to finish and said, mm-hmm. do you want to hang around and do some of this? Generally, they said yes. So I think we've got a plan. I just don't know all the details to that plan yet.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
So that was a good answer about you think it would only might get fixed with $1.5 million. I know you don't know, but I'm glad to hear that.
A lot of time us project managers work in gut levels. And,
I know. You know
and I always add, we'll figure it out.
Good. Well, that's why we're glad that you're there to give us your view and your recommendations. So we have 2,500 seats that are still remaining. So how does this work affect the, you know, replacing those seats?
We made the fundamental decision to finish the seats. Okay. In a few places, we'll have to go back and remove those work. But trying to coordinate that, we've gotten too finite and too technical. So if we have to, and actually when we bid this job, we put an allowance in there for a fixed cost to remove a seat and to reinstall it by the seat installer.
I see. Good.
So we have a number. It's not going to be, we know what it's going to cost. And it's not material in my mind to how we approach this. We studied it. We've talked it through with the facilities folks at the stadium. But those 2,500 seats are scheduled to go in. We said we'd get those done. We need to get those done. Then we'll start building the attic stock or the extra seats that they'll have and storage if something breaks on one of them. And Bob is doing kind of a fun thing. He's the logo is going into part of the seats on the lower level. So not at your expense, but Titan expense, but it's actually pretty cool. I saw the first glimpses of the word Titan spelled out in seats on the lower west side, east side. So we'll pick away at it.
Okay, thanks.
Other questions? I did hear from Dudley this morning that he went to the game, and of all things, he had to sit last week in an old seat. So
we've resolved that. I'm satisfied with your answer.
I won't promise, but I'll almost commit that by the time the regular season starts, that won't be a problem.
I would suggest, so I may not be sitting there again, but I do have just a couple of questions because I want to get clear on where we are on the budget. So you indicated you're $1.5 million under budget.
Correct.
Is that what you said?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And then does that include the contingency fee?
Yeah. If you take everything that we have in reserves in the budgets, allowances, contingencies, and unspent funds, it's about $1.5 million.
Okay.
Might be a tad north of that, but I think that's a good round number for today.
And our contingency, how much was our contingency?
Well, we had, that's an Ed question, about $600,000.
It looks like it's about $600,000 or $700,000.
In the project contingency.
Okay. But you feel comfortable that the $1.5 million, you feel comfortable that this additional cost of $1.3 million for these seals can be met and can be encompassed in the original budget?
Yeah, at least we will make a very large dent into it. And like I say, I'll know more next month. Mr. Lackey and I have had an ongoing conversation about some of those details. So I think I've got everybody where, including you, where we are. We just got to get into it and execute the plan and start to put quantities to it. But when we look back at what we fixed, when we look forward to what we think we have to fix, we think if we don't get it all, and part of the reason we're categorizing these from an engineering standpoint in A, B, and C priorities, mm-hmm. It's just in case it does get tight, we maybe not do some C's, but save that for the next round or whatever. So where it might be leaking into the lower tunnel or something like that, where it's not a big priority. I know that's a little bit less definitive than I like to often share, but that's kind of where we are today.
So I would just like to say that I really appreciate the creativity of utilizing the Tennessee State University engineering students. I'm sure that it's not a great learning opportunity for them. But back to originally, I had asked about a breakout on the diversity numbers, and I'm still trying to figure out of that 8% ethnic minority, how much of that is black participation?
Where is Roxanne? You want to come up here? Yes, you need to for the record. And you notice on the right side the breakdown.
Mm-hmm. What I can do for...
Will you please introduce yourself, Roxanne?
Oh, sorry. Roxanne Bethune. I'm the diversity business manager on the project working under Commonwealth Development. The name of my company is Alliance Synergy Group. Plug.
Shameless.
But as it relates to the diversity side of it, we do have a company out of
Maryland.
Thank you. I was going to say Boston, but yeah, Maryland. That's working with the prime contractor on the seats. He does have a local group that's here mobilized, and they do stay here on the project. So what we see is that they are contributing heavily back into the economy in Nashville. And I can give you that breakdown on our next report if you'd like to, is exactly how much money we've spent with them. I didn't bring it with me today. But what I'm thinking I may do for the next report is actually just itemize all of them out and just list the names of those vendors that are actually participating.
That would be great. So we do have some local
They do. We have Trojan Labor, which is working with them as well. We have Specialty Coating, which is a local company that's working on the project. So we've got some local participation, but I just want to go back to the point that Larry made. Because of the fact that it is such a specialized, most of it is the labor workforce that's mm-hmm. involved in the project. But as you can imagine, that's quite a bit as well.
Thank you.
Okay.
Are there any other questions for Larry?
Briefly.
Yes.
Larry, you said that some of these additional problems that we're about to go into, were those because they were an initial inspection missed, or it's because you move something and then you go, oops, there's a problem?
More the latter. You know, what we could visually see on the lower levels versus the upper levels is more contained. So as we pulled out seats and we took covers off, that's kind of when we started to unfold a larger degree. And then working with the facilities guys, we kind of paired that up with what they were seeing as they were renovating suites and so forth.
And you did say that now they have a report or a mechanism to determine if there's areas that's still having problems.
We think we've identified ways to communicate that with each other. Yes, okay. Sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Margaret Darby, this we don't need to vote per se on this item, correct? This is more of a briefing. Okay. Just wanted to make sure. And if Larry, if you'll please keep, I know Lisa Howes, our liaison to the sure. Nissan Stadium, informed. I know it's a long time till our next meeting next month. And if there's anything we need to know, please communicate it through Lisa.
And Monica and I have sort of a set conversation every Friday morning. So that's
excellent.
That's, yep.
Thank you for your report.
All right. Thank you.
Next up, we have representatives from the Tennessee Titans for the Nissan Stadium report.
Good morning, Board. Bob Flynn with Nissan Stadium. You know, like I always want to say, Larry's been great to work with, his whole group. Roxanne's been great to work with, and Powell Building Group has been great. And I think that's why that partnership there with those two is why we're under budget so much. So they've done a great job. But just to make mine, point over there. There it is. Mine should be fairly short today. Since last meeting, we've had the training camp practices. Well, we had two open houses. Unfortunately, the first one got rained out because of weather. And so we rescheduled for the following Monday. And the nice thing about the August 6th one, even though it was rained out, we did get a little practice with our shelter and in place to make sure everybody was safe during the event. And then we had our first preseason game last Saturday. And I saw Rip there. How was your seat? There you go. Sorry, Dudley. We'll work on yours. But we had a great game last. You know, it was preseason, but you know, I think the atmosphere was real positive there. And I had some issues come up, but nothing major. Everything was good. And so we got through that. Now we've got another one this Saturday, which we're excited about as well. Then after that, we've got the TSU John Merritt Classic on the 3rd, which we're excited about having that. We should have another good show like we did last year. And then we have our season opener on September 11th, which we're real excited about this season about. And then we go Beyonce on the 2nd, and New Zealand and Mexico on the 8th. And a couple weeks ago, we had the announcement with the mayor there. And the head of the Mexican Federation was there, and our Steve Underwood was there, and it was a nice event. I mean, this event is going to go back. They have 4 different television stations carrying this game, 1 here in the U.S. and 3 over in South America. So it's going to be, you know, this is going to get Nashville out there quite a bit. It's going to be a fun game. The environment that the Mexican faithful will have is incredible. I mean, they're very passionate about their soccer down there. Let's see. So improvements. I think it was about 2 meetings ago we talked about the South Lawn project, about redoing that South Lawn area. We are still doing that, but it's going to take us a little longer. We've got to do some drainage testing, which I think was going to start today, and then we're going to get a timeline. We're not sure if we're going to do it during this season or not, because right now we're activating that area right now for, we've got bands out there before every game. We're having our pregame radio show out there. We're just trying to add some more excitement to the season and to the game experience. PSL Founder Wall and the new signs. What I'm really proud about, the new signs for the partners, that's TSU, Music City Bowl, and CMA. We're going to do that. Last year or before, they had three really bad-looking signs on the back of the North scoreboard. Now we're going to have three really nice signs on both the North and South. They're going to be backlit, and it's going to be really nice looking signs. And we've had sign off from all three groups, and they're real excited about it because it's definitely an upgrade of what we've had in the past. Nissan Hall of Greats, this goes into what we're doing inside the building. We've got 10 touchscreen TV screens where you can go up there and you can touch a name, and it will show you all the highlights of what Eddie George did during his career or whomever that's made the Pro Bowl for the Titans. We're real excited about that because it's just added more to the fan experience being inside the building. You know, we're painting inside, we're still painting outside. We're doing a lot of work still with the seats and the expansion joint, but I'm really happy about where we are and the changes we've made. We've heard from a number of people just saying, gosh, the stadium looks so much better right now. We're excited about where we are, but we're not finished with it at all, and we're trying to improve everything we can every day, which I think I've said to you all before, that's our goal, is to improve, you know, each event. So I think that's about all I have. Questions, please.
So, Bob, these stadium improvements, my understanding the Titans are paying for all of these.
All of these right here we are paying for, yes. The South Lawn Project, the PSL Founder Wall, the new signs, and the Hall of Greats.
I think that's terrific, and I want to thank the organization for these improvements. They are exciting, and I think they're doing what you want to accomplish with the building, so thank you.
Well, ownership is really, it all starts up there, and they have said, you know, let's improve the fan experience. Let's improve what we have there. So couldn't do it without them.
So Bob, if I tell you where my opening day tickets are, you can
Ralph,
tell me.
I will take care of you. Yes, I would take care of all of you. I want to take care of everybody that comes into the building. So, but glad to have everybody there. And if y'all ever need anything, please don't hesitate. I think Stuart Spears is going to come up and talk to you about ticket sales.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Stuart, will you remind everyone your title of the organization?
My name is Stuart Spears. I appreciate the opportunity to be here this morning. I'm the Senior Vice President and Chief Revenue Officer for the organization. To update you a little bit on how our ticket sales have been going for this season, we began renewals, as you know, back in February and have gone through the spring. Invoicing and encouraging fans to renew their season tickets as much as we could. Part of the efforts were our service team, which is now up to 6 full-time employees, making contact with each season ticket member via email or phone call to ensure that they don't have any questions or have any needs that they can help with, and then also a series of engagements with the fans over the course of the off-season. Starting with the luncheon we did at the Music City Center back in February that you're familiar with, that ownership and our new head coach were at, to Titans Tuesdays we ran during the spring for season ticket members. And then this summer we've had training camp visits where we have a special tent for season ticket members that are able to come to, season ticket deliveries for randomly selected members that had players and staff deliver their season ticket members to them. We'll continue during the year to try and have activities that are catering just to season ticket members to make sure they understand how special and important they are to us. Mike Keith, the voice of the Titans, will host luncheons at the stadium weekly during the season for groups of season ticket members. And then at the games themselves, we'll continue the Titan Up flag, which you may recognize comes out during the national anthem that is held by season ticket members up there. And then we have a new function this year that our head coach actually came up with the idea, encouraged us to pull together, and that's lining the home team tunnel with season ticket members. We have kind of a new lighting and pyrotechnic show to go around the players during their introductions, and so that tunnel will be full of season ticket members high-fiving and cheering for the players as they come up for warm-ups. And then we will also at home games continue to have pregame receptions for season ticket members with alumni players so they can meet some of the Titan greats from the past, as well as have an opportunity for some food and beverage with our staff before they enjoy the Titan games. Renewals have been going well, have been encouraging. We've are renewing at a higher rate than we were last year, which is always the direction you would prefer to go. And our new season ticket sales are still trending ahead of last year as well, so we're looking for that number to keep going. We have an extensive advertising campaign that's running throughout the region, outdoor, print, television, radio, that is at its peak right now and will continue to run at this high level through the end of the preseason and into the regular season to keep pushing that season ticket member number up as high as we can. So that's a quick run through of tickets. See if we have any questions. Nope. All right, appreciate you having me here. Thanks.
Thank you, Stuart.
Hello, everyone. My name's Janine Kaufman. I'm Senior Vice President and Chief Financial Officer at the Titans, and so glad to be here today. I'm not going to go through this, but I want to point out that we did give every single person one of these reports. It's our 2015 Community Impact Report. It's an annual report, and it's something that you guys can take home with you and look through. It kind of goes over all the events that we did to impact the community throughout the year, and it's actually our first document that we have done like this. And so I think it really summarizes the impact of what the Titans are doing in the community. Two items I do really want to point out, because this was something new that we've done, is we were the primary sponsor along with Bridgestone Arena and United Way for the United Way Stuff the Bus Days of Action. In the past, we have always walked the kids back to school, but this year we actually made a financial contribution as well to actually sponsor the backpack that was given out to MNPS on the first day of school to elementary schools. It was to 9 different MNPS schools, and every child at those MNPS elementary schools got a backpack. It was over 8,500 backpacks, and the backpacks were stuffed with all of the school supplies for those kids. And it was just an amazing day. We did also participate in walking the kids back to school, and we were at Buena Vista this year, and it's an emotional day, and it's so exciting to see those kids. It's really, really cool. Marcus also participated with the back-to-school program, and so really wanted to highlight him with the mayor there being a part of that great, great community event and really, you know, setting the tone for those future business leaders and employees here in Nashville. So really exciting stuff there. The other item I want to point out is John Robinson is going to be our primary spokesperson for the Nashville Business Breakfast, which is hosted by Lipscomb University and the Nashville Business Journal, and that's on September 6th. So if you have an opportunity to come out and hear him speak, we'd love to have you guys there too. So, and we're really excited about that because we're going to try kind of act like a pep rally that day and have some giveaways. Cheerleaders, T-Rack will be there, so it'll be very cool. All right, moving into my boring stuff, which is the financial stuff. It's not really boring, but kind of boring. Let's review the ticket user fee first. If you'll remember, the user fee is $3, and it's divided into two different funds. The first is the $2 ticket tax fund, and that supports the 2012 bonds that were issued. That money is coming in and going out, and it's supporting the bonds, and the detail for that is also in your pack. There is a summary of since inception of that, and the current fund balance of that is $474,000 some odd. Again, as a reminder, these are not my funds. These are funds that Bob Lackey takes care of. Thank you, Bob. And these reports actually are produced by Bob, but we provide them to you for information. The next is the dollar user fee fund, and it's divided, of course, into multiple funds. The 1.9 is the bond reserve fund. There is a current balance in the fund of $1.4 million. We've got interest of about $2 million that's been earned, and then the loan balance is about $9.2 million. Now, that difference differs a little bit from the number that Larry gave you, where he said the spend was a little over $10 million, and that's due to timing. So We pay, you know, the contractors, and then we submit for reimbursement to Bob, and then Bob reimburses us. And so there's a little bit of lag time there between those numbers. So that's just to clarify that a little bit. The ticket tax paid to date, this shows a little over $15.5 million that has been paid since inception of the ticket tax. I want to highlight fiscal year 15 and fiscal year 16. It does look like it went down from 15 to 16. However, that is primarily due to the timing of when the CMA tickets for next year went on sale. So in fiscal year 15, CMA went on sale for the 16 event in April. So there was April, May, and June collections for CMA. This year for 2017 event for CMA, they didn't put those on sale until mid-June. And the reasoning for that was because CMA had the new stage this year. And they wanted the fans to be able to sit in those seats and make sure they liked them before they actually did the renewal process. And so that's why they waited until June to make sure that their fans liked their seat before they sent out a renewal. So just to kind of give you, that's why, so it's really a timing issue. It's not that the ticket revenue was down for that particular fiscal year. This is a user fee recap. Again, we're paying this. This is for the Titans only, and we're paying this in installments of $162,000. At our next meeting, of course, I'll have the true-up for the two games that are played in August. And so you'll see that at the next meeting where we actually true-up once the game is finalized and we actually produce the official box office statement. So you'll see that come through at our next meeting in September. The capital fund is sitting at $1.5 million. There was $1 million that's contributed into that fund annually, and this is pretty much the same as it was at our last meeting, so no change really in this except for maybe a small little bit of interest. And this is the capital fund summary to date. So you can kind of see that money since inception going through. And this is where we stand as far as receivable goes. The casualty receivable did drop from our last meeting. Walter has done a great job of working with Metro and collecting some of that. So we got a small check in, and that reduced that casualty receivable. And the unfiled reimbursement went up, and that's because we had some invoices that were received. And so I'm just going to move to the communication tool, unless anyone has any specific questions about the user fee funds or the ticket tax funds or capital fund. Yes.
Next year, will the CMA tickets go on sale sooner? Go back to?
They have not made that determination yet, Kim, to my knowledge, so I'm not exactly sure. If they do put the 18 event on sale in April, then you're going to see a large increase, you know, from fiscal year 16 to fiscal year 17.
Thank you.
Anything? Okay. I'm going to move to the CapEx communication tool, which I think everyone has. And I'm just going to go briefly through and highlight. This is, I do send a communication to Margaret and Monica, Margaret Darby, sorry, and Monica and Alicia with some of the changes that happened month to month. And just to recap some of those changes, we had invoices that were received for the ticket office renovation. That renovation project is almost complete, and you'll see some more invoices come through at our next meeting for that. The light raker paint projects, if you've looked at the stadium, you can see some of the light rakers are almost complete, right, Bob? Two more left. So as we complete that work, we receive more invoices, and then the bathroom renovation project is continuing on. I will tell you this, I know Bob's really excited when he gets up here and talks about the bathrooms, but I've got to tell you, I had more people come up to me at the game and say, wow, what a difference it makes. They look beautiful. So if you do get an opportunity to pop your head in there and check them out, don't laugh at me back there. The next thing is we had the club furniture project and the magnetometers. Those moved off the current list to the completed list. Those projects have been closed out. Walter and Jeff do an annual inspection of the parking lots each year, and so they completed that inspection, and we sent two quotes over, and we hope to have some of that work done. That's kind of resealing, restriping. They basically walk the parking lots every single year this time of year, and then we try and do any repair work before the winter rolls around. So we We've sent two quotes over, and that work will start. The ticket office renovation I talked about already. There was a change in the overall price of the ticket office project, and that was because we put new carpet in. Once we got in there, the carpet was really old, so that was a change order that happened. And then we also added a awning to the new outside ticket windows, and that was also a change order. So you'll see that total cost in that project had gone up. We finalized the contract for the access control system, so that got moved to the current list. There are no invoices that have been received to date, and that contract has been supplied as well. And then this kind of came up during late July, right after our meeting. We received a letter from the NFL, and they had a mandatory requirement that in the home and visiting tunnels where the players come out, we had to put a non-slip surface in that area, and that was an NFL requirement that came down. We received a quote on 7/28, and that work has been completed. So that never was on an anticipated list. It went straight to the current list because we didn't know about it until the league sent the letter, which was dated 7/13. So those are the changes in the communication tool since our last meeting. Does anybody have any questions on the communication tool or any questions about any of those items?
Dudley?
At the last meeting, in the minutes, there was Mr. Reebling came and talked about putting together a plan to address unfiled reimbursements and also capital needs for the stadium. And our minutes reflect that we're supposed to have more information about that at this meeting. Has there been any progress in that in the last month?
I will defer to Monica on that. I think they've had a few meetings on that with some and getting some bids, is my understanding. Bob attended one of those meetings, but I will defer to Monica or Metro.
Well, I think when
Metro.
Rich was here last month and he talked about you know, the need to look at this 5 to 10 years out, and we wanted to do that. We feel like it's important to really understand what's going on in the building, and so we talked about having someone come and really analyze the different systems in the building, and so that's still where we are now. There was the meeting. I was out of town when that took place. Lisa was there. I've had multiple conversations with Lisa and with Larry and Rich, and so at this point, we're moving forward. We've received one proposal. We're going to see what other proposals we get, and then we'll just continue to go from there. So at this point, there's not anything specific to report back, but we're still working on that and trying to see what we can do in terms of understanding exactly what's going on in the facility and how that translates into future improvements and, of course, the financial part of that.
And the past.
And the past. That's right. Yes, and the past.
All right. Well, thank you so much.
I want to say, too, and if Bob, I'm going to put Bob on the spot. If he could come up real quickly, I want to go back to...
Do you want Lackey or Flynn?
I'm sorry, Bob Flynn. Yes, Bob Flynn.
Yes, Monica.
I was going to say, I don't know, you all may be aware that September 7th through the 11th, Nashville is hosting Marine Week. I think there have been some things out in the news and the press about that. So basically, we're going to have thousands of Marines that are going to descend. There's going to be a series of events and appearances, and so it's going to be a good week. September 11th, of course, is the Titans home opener, and so I wanted to get you to speak to that, if you will. There's also a special demo that's planned, and I want to make sure that the board is aware of it. And for anyone who may be watching this on TV, I think the more notice we can give of this event, I think the better.
So on September 11th, yes, it's our home opener. It's a conclusion of Marine Week here at in Nashville. And what they're going to do, an exercise where they're going to bring helicopters flying down Broadway, and they're going to go around the stadium. And I agree, everybody's going, wait a second, we got, you know, 65,000 people at our stadium, and you got helicopters going around and all that stuff. Is that a good thing or not? I was very worried about that as well. They have promised about, you know, I've noticed a billboard on 65 promoting it. I've heard it on radio. But so they are promoting it, and that's what we have to get out there, the message of what Monica wants to get out there. But they're going to go around the stadium, and then they're going to, I forget which way they're going to go up or down the Cumberland, and they're going to stage like an attack on the west side of the river side, and they're going to blow up three bunkers, and they're going to have an amphibious vehicles come onto the property, and there'll be some pyro there and stuff like that. I was a little bit worried about it, or quite a bit. I mean, at one point they wanted to close down streets, and we said, no, you can't do that from 10:40. I mean, the timing is 10:15 to 10:45. They're going to have a band on the east side of the river, and then from 10:45 to 11:15 is this process. The pyro is supposed to be over at 11, and it's all on the east side of the railroad tracks. So it's not going to be on, you know, it's not going to affect any of our parking or our traffic. But I was concerned about the noise, and, you know, you're at a stadium, and we all know what's happening out in the world right now.
On September 11th.
Yeah, and September 11th and all that stuff. So we have voiced our concerns. Walter and I have been on a couple phone calls about it.
And the mayor's office and the special events team has been, we've met with the Marines multiple times. There have been many, many meetings, many conversations. And so the Titans have been involved in this, but we just want to make sure that you all are aware when the helicopters come, and this, of course, is 10:45 to 11:15, so, you know, peak pregame, and so we just wanted to let you all know.
The key part is going to be getting that communication out, and and they've, like I said, I saw in 65 driving in on Monday or Tuesday, a big billboard, digital board, and I've heard it on the radio. So, but, you know, they promised that they'll give us some stuff so we can send out to our season ticket holders to make sure they're aware of it. You know, we're actually going to honor the Marines during our game as well. So it does make me a little bit, I shouldn't say concerned, but, you know, as long as we get the communication out there. But some people could be surprised. It could be a pretty cool show also.
How are they advertising it as far as what's the message of what they're doing? I mean, are they letting people know that
there
will be an exercise and
I mean,
not to be
they're
concerned?
Actually going on Thursday the 8th, if I do my math right, maybe I'm wrong, they're going to do a test at the stadium or, you know, by on the riverside. They're going to do something on Friday the 9th and then on the 11th for us as well. So we can tweak things there, but they've got a whole thing with the Tennessean. They've already made partnerships with Tennessean. I think it's a big deal. For Nashville to have this here, but it just coincidentally.
And we are excited about the Marines coming. I just wanted to make sure that you all were notified, and, you know, any viewing public is aware. And I think the more notice, the better.
I got one parenthetical thing to add. We're working extensively with them right now too on how to land all this equipment on Riverfront Park as they come off the Titan side. We figured out how to get them in there, and their planning is incredible. Yeah. So then their details. So just added that.
Thank you, Larry. Thank you, Bob.
Okay, thanks. Next up, we have the consideration of the CMA parking settlement report, and I think Monica is going to take the lead on that.
Yes, I will. Under the 2012 license agreement between the Sports Authority and the CMA, the Sports Authority allows CMA the use of the facilities, and then the CMA has agreed to divide and pay out the net revenue of the parking proceeds. So 25% goes to the Sports Authority, 25% to the Titans, and 50% to the CMA. Both the 2016 and the 2015 parking settlement summaries are in your packet. Also, behind tab 2 in the executive director's report, I think it's on the third page, is a comparison table, which might be a little easier if you want to look through. But basically, when we look at 2016, the four-day parking revenue was $192,918.08. The individual day parking is $286,162.01. Total parking expenses, the parking expenses as well as the revenue went down this year as compared to last year. And total net parking was $183,899.
So that boils down to a almost $46,000 share to the Sports Authority. So it's very similar to last year. We're looking at about $41 difference between 2015 and 2016. If you have any specific questions, Brasher is here, and I'm sure that he would be more than happy to answer some, but this does require approval from the board, and we recommend approval.
Are there any questions? Okay, is there a motion for approval of the CMA?
I'll so move.
I'll second.
Motion and second.
I'd like to disclose that I recuse myself due to my affiliation of representing Stewart's.
Thank you, Margaret.
Okay, we have a motion, a second, one recusal. All in favor say aye.
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 Motion carries. Okay, at this time, I believe Sean Henry and Adam Stover with Populous are going to give us an update on the study at our venue here, Bridgestone Arena.
Well, good morning. We're excited about this. I know we're supposed to be brief, and as you know, it's not my strong suit, so we'll try.
We're tracking well this morning, so it's on you.
Yeah, we're only 48 minutes in already. we're excited about this project, and we talked about this about 6 months ago. And you got to go back a few years. When we first did a visioning study, it was in 2010, if you remember. And at that time, the building was 12, 13, 14 years old, whatever it may be. And the worst thing that we heard on every show, every time someone visited from out of town, they'd say, how old is this building? 20 years old, 25 years old? And you'd almost cry and say, no, it's 12 years old. And so we went out with the visioning study, and we said, you know, this is going to take us out 10, 15, 20 years to improve the building, to change what we are, what we can be. Ideally, it's going to help us go from the 20th, 30th, 40th busiest building in the country to maybe the top 15 was really the goal. But an odd thing happens when you start looking 15, 20 years down the road, you start seeing your current business a lot more clearly. And at that time, I think we identified 90 or 100 or 200 projects, small, large, everything in between. And what it ended up leading to was about a $60 million five-year renovation plan. Of that $60 million, $20, $22 million came from the capital improvement fund that we created. The rest of it came from our owners and private investment. But it changed our building fundamentally. Now when someone comes into our building for the first time or the first time in a few years, they always say, how old is this building? You know, 5, 10 years old? And it's always nice to say, no, it's actually about to turn 20 years of age. And then along the same period of time, we went from being the 30th busiest building in the country, whatever it was, to virtually year in and year out a top five busiest building. There's no coincidence of how that happens. But along the same conversation, what happens in our industry is normally, building for whatever reason, people think it's gonna last 30 years. Part of it is probably because the bonds are taken out 30 years. Part of it is most leases are 30-year leases. And I've never understood it. Because when you look at some of the most iconic buildings in the country, they're not talking about being replaced in year 15 or 20 or 25. They just renovate, whether it be Fenway Park, Wrigley Field, Soldier Field, Madison Square Garden. If you have a great building in a great part of town, what you need to do is keep that engine going and not start looking for the new replacement. So again, most buildings, that 30-year cycle, you have a peak, you need to grow for about 15 years, maybe 16 years, then you start falling off. Fortunately for us, years 15 through 20 have been our five best years, with each year passing the year before on every front, for the hockey team and the arena. So what we're talking about now is how do we take what's going so well right now, economic impact is just booming, over $400 million a year, how do we take that forward and start looking 20, 30, 40, 50 years down the road and not giggle when we say it? Because if today you guys voted and said, here's $700 million, go build the greatest arena ever built, wherever you want it to be, but it can't be at 501 Broadway, we'd say no. And fortunately, according to Monica and Emmett yesterday at least, and our friends in the mayor's office, everyone agrees with that. This is the best place for this building. We all know what it did 20 years ago, what it continues to do. So 6 months ago, we decided to take on the project of looking 15, 20, 25, 30 years down the road and start identifying what we could do with this building. And that's the real key. A few members of the media back there are going to start banging us up saying, okay, which one of these projects are you doing exactly? When do you start? When do you break ground? How much is it going to be? This study's not about this. This is a very high-level study to really look at space management more so than anything else. It's an exercise in geometry, basically, looking at our plot, going 6th Avenue to 5th Avenue to Mumbrian to Broadway and figuring out how can we use more of that to take care of some of the current deficiencies of the building. Not that there are many, but there's one or two we'd like to change after being around for 20 years. More importantly, how will people continue to evolve and how they spectate or participate or consume our entertainment? How do we live into that? How do we continue to make this one of the busiest buildings in the country while maintaining right where we are? And that's by looking at it and figuring out what else can we do on the property. So the projects you're gonna see that Adam's gonna walk you through, we're not building a tower, we're not building an ice rink, we're not building 50 restaurants, we're not blowing all the concourses out to the street corners and opening the building up and covering the terrace and having indoor and outdoor spaces. What we wanted to see is if we could do that from a physical standpoint, if we did build a tower over here, whether it be a hotel or a condo or apartment or a bowling alley or a cycling center, whatever you could do in 30 stories, if we did that, what has to be replaced? What else do we need to achieve? We need the concourses bigger, we need more bathrooms, we need more points of sale. We need to change how the building functions. Buildings used to be designed in a very introverted fashion. You wanted to control what happened. You almost built a wall around it. Where today, you want to be extroverted. You really want to play in and out of where you are, and especially where we sit, right off of Broadway, right off of SoBro, you really want to tie into that energy. So what we're throwing out there now for us to really start to consider, start figure out what we need to do to take this building forward 30 years, are some of these projects. And just like we did 6 years ago, of all the projects we identified, I don't think any of them married up to the report that we did, but it started spurring on, what should we do? How can we do it? How do we look at the building a little bit differently? And again, an odd thing happened. We were looking 15 years down the road, 6 years ago, but in that 6 year span, you know, we fundamentally changed what this building was. And I think this is the first step of what we're gonna take on. And it's really exciting that, you know, you encouraged us to do it. You know, Monica and Emmett, thanks for coming over yesterday to see the final report, or the draft anyway. And this is an exciting time for us because I know where it can lead us. And just like Madison Square Garden went through a 5 year renovation cycle, we'll do the same thing. And again, the real key is we're gonna identify some things that we see as a challenge, but when we work together, we'll figure out a way to bring them about. And again, our goal is very simple as an organization: be the best venue in America built around a Stanley Cup championship team. Looking at projects this way and looking 15, 20 years down the road, that's what's gonna get us this year or next year or the year after. So excited about it, look forward to answering your questions. But the only thing we want you to take away from, this is not a map saying this is what we're gonna do. This is really the start of the conversation of, here are some of the things we can do with the building, then we figure out how to do it to achieve where we wanna go. So you've met Adam Stover before, but if you don't remember, he's a principal with Populous. He's been working with us for 6 years on all of our projects and probably the most creative guy in the industry right now. So we're pretty happy to have him as our partner. So good luck, Adam.
I paid him to say that, by the way. Yeah, so I'm excited to be here. As always, it's fun to be in Nashville. So we've got a lot of slides. I know we'll try to manage time the best. So a lot of the slides have a lot of words. I'll key in on a couple items, but then we'll keep moving. So.
And we'll email you all the report after the meeting as well, so you have it.
So as Sean talked about, you know, where do we go? What is the goal of this initial vision, as we call it? And really, it's an exploration. You know, it's a high-level vision of what's possible for the future of the arena, and then the direct impact that it would have around the elements directly adjacent to it. And really, for us, it was intended to create a conversation around the opportunity for development and enhancements and revenue generators that will each have, we think, a measurable return on investment. So, you know, we've come up with a list of goals, but I just want to highlight a handful of them, read through them quickly. You know, number one, it's extend the life of the building. That's key. Everything we need to, everything we are studying, everything we're looking at, we have to make sure it goes back to that. Also, what are the required updates to the building, both infrastructure and systems? You know, that's important as anything else we would do. We got to make sure that the core elements of the building are intact and are strategically placed for the next 30 years. We want to extend the Broadway experience through Bridgestone Arena. You know, right now, we would argue that it almost stops at Fifth many days, and we want to continue that. And not only continue it on Broadway up to Sixth, but wrap it around the building. Really make that building a 365-day-a-year experience. You know, we want to evaluate all the spaces for the greatest way to utilize them and for future development. And as Sean mentioned, as we've been breaking this down at a very high level, as we touch different elements, you know, it causes reactions across the building. So I think you'll see that. You know, we started with some of the core elements and corners, and we've just kind of looked at them at a high level in terms of what makes sense at the different positions. You know, we want to reimagine the in-game event experience. Concourse connectivity is a big one. We want to look at how can we improve capacity. You know, we're very fortunate here. We're selling out concerts, we're selling out games. Is there an opportunity to increase capacity? You know, how would we take that on? You know, we're looking at things as far as the press box. You know, when this building was built, we truly don't have an NHL press box. So can we fix that? Can we reposition it? Is it possible within the current confines? You know, one of the other big picture elements that we looked at is, could we bring an ice sheet onto the facility? Could we bring a second sheet of ice? Would it be possible to relocate the training facilities here year-round? Is it doable right now? So we've taken a look at that. Sean mentioned for site conditions, you know, we could easily and excitedly, you know, sway to either side, but for the purposes of our initial kind of brainstorming and high-level explorations, we've stuck between 6th and 5th and Demumbrian and Broadway and really stayed true to the curb-to-curb discussion. And we spent a lot of time, too, talking with the team, talking internally about connectivity and what that means and how it has transformed in the last 20 years and will continue to grow in the next 20 to 30 years. And, you know, for the next 20 to 30, it's a lot of speculation, but it's important that we kind of step back, think about it. You know, right now it's all about being connected. It's, you know, all about inclusivity. The millennial generation wants to be included. They want the now. It's all about the experience. So, you know, we've kind of broken down and we looked at four keys. You know, number one is the fan base, the evolution of the experience itself. We looked at the evolution of hospitality from clubs to suites to all those different elements. And then the, you know, constraints of the existing arena. And, you know, how do we utilize those to our advantage? You know, so, you know, we spend a lot of time talking about the millennial, maybe too much often. You know, we talk about, coined the term FOMO, the fear of missing out. That is, you know, what we're working with and what we think we'll continue to see. We have evolved, though, from a spectate crowd to a participate crowd. And I think, you know, it's participation not only in the game, but participation in media, participation in club environments. And it's as much as you are there now, or we're seeing fans there now for the spectacle that is the sport on the field, it in many cases becomes secondary. So they're there, they want to be a part of it, but they want to be a part of something else. Their attention span has changed. You know, and just a couple other, you know, they demand authenticity, they'll share it. And, you know, that's something we really have to take into account as we're thinking about these new experiences, is that they can share it and have it help us, or it can definitely take a 180 if we're not careful. So we have to truly think and dissect those elements as we're weaving them in. You know, and they crave adventure and discoveries. I mean, these are two images on the right of the party deck at Everbank Stadium for the Jaguars. You know, 6 years ago, if you asked us if we would be putting infinity pools on one end zone above a club with some of the best DJs in the country playing behind it during the first quarter, I would have laughed at least, but we're doing it. And the impact that it's having, not only on the demographic, but the experience as a whole is you know, evolution is a big thing. You know, where are we today versus where we were? What are some of the things we did here day one that we really need to rework or rethink? Spending a lot of time looking at improved food and beverage options, looking at technology, looking at enhanced AV experiences. You know, credit to the organization, to the Sports Authority. You know, we're blessed to have a facility where we've continued to do a lot of things. But what we know is that the upswing that we're continuing to take, as Sean mentioned, we just have to continue to push all these things so that we won't stop moving in that direction. Weaving in the brand outside of the arena walls is really important. I think when the building was built, it was very introverted. You know, a lot of hard edges, not a lot of glass. You know, in the last couple of years with the retail store, we were able to add 60 feet of glass, and really you got kind of one of your first kind of views almost into the concourse. So, you know, we know those are elements that we have to continue to weave in and push. And then, you know, the improvement for fans to meet and mingle. You know, I mean, I think, again, you know, the team was able to facilitate that up on, in a small level on the upper concourse. where they came in, created an opening where fans now up there could engage while still watching the event on the field. It's highly important for the new demographic, I think, for fans in general, and that's something we just don't really have today at the in the facility. You know, we've talked a lot about just varieties of seating types. I think, you know, again, we've been studying these in small sectors with different types of club experiences, different types of seating over the last few years, but it's something we continue to look at and need to look at. Club spaces are huge. I think when the building was built, when many buildings were built in this time frame, it was a lot of courtside club, sideline club locations, but that's really transformed. As I noted in here, you know, we're really going now to every demographic. It's not a have and have nots. You know, everybody wants that club experience at a different level. It allows a lot of opportunity for brand integration. We can talk about regional personality and inclusivity that way. So it's kind of transformed from one to two to now everybody expects some sort of an environment. And then of course our site surroundings. You know, modern arenas act as, you know, it's inclusive activity, you know, entities for the city, and everything is driven around them. You know, previously when this building was built, it's kind of the opposite. Again, you know, it was just kind of hard walls, everything was internal. We really didn't have, we weren't really focused on pushing everything to the outside. And so with the images that you'll see here in a second, with our study, as we've been looking at it, we're definitely focused on doing that. I shared this last time, but this just kind of breaks down the comparables. I think it's important to see, you know, highlighting some of the busiest arenas in the country, all built, you know, within 2 to 3 years of Bridgestone Arena, and to see the commitment that they've made on renovations. You know, we see that Bankers Life Fieldhouse, Phillips Arena, they're currently, you know, embarking on renovations, and we think, you know, hopefully together we'll be right behind them. So what does this mean at a high level? Where do we think we can go? You know, I've broken this down quickly, starting just with a single plan, talking about really the core corners that, because of how the building was situated day one, what they allow us, which I think is pretty cool. And then we'll go starting at 5th and Broadway and just kind of weave our way around clockwise, ending at 6th and Demumbrian, and kind of showing how what the transformation opportunities and possibilities are. A couple of the main things, though, that we'll talk in case I miss when we're going through images. We want to improve vertical circulation. We want to create wider concourses. We know we need to increase the number of toilets and concessions. You know, we are hitting the required mark, but that's not good enough. We need to really make sure that no one's ever needing to wait in a line. And so if we're going to look at this big picture, let's see how we can do that. You know, we've increased the amenities at all levels, not just the main concourse, not just the upper. You know, how can truly at every level create indoor, interior, and exterior opportunities for engagement 365? Increase the number of entry lobbies. That was really important for us to look at as the traffic patterns are changing for people coming into the building. You know, I think previously it was really all about 5th and Broadway. With the convention center coming on, the parking garages, it's really changing how people are entering the building. And so we now know that we have a need on Demumbrian to really widen that entrance, to pay particular attention to that. So we've studied that a bit. You know, one of the other things that we've thrown out, in addition to ice sheets, we've looked at conference centers. And, you know, we've got, we're blessed with conference meeting space here in the facility. But we know, you know, we see the evolution of the conference, of the convention center, needs that are happening there. So we're studying those types of things. How can we play off and support one another? You know, another one was creating a new front door for the team. And the offices as a whole. Right now, when you come in, you know, it's kind of a pathway through. Can we change that experience? Can we truly create a front door for the facility day in, day out when there's not an event going on? So this plan shows the existing conditions, and highlighted in gold are kind of the three areas that we looked at a high level of degree in terms of just how the building positions itself day one. These elements starting at the, I guess, top left, the parking garage. So we studied the parking garage discussions. You know, there are not a lot of spots in that garage. We see it as an opportunity structurally, the way it was created, to really say, okay, that is a parcel of land on or acreage that we can take and kind of rework. That's an opportunity that won't. And I think with all these things, it's important to know that, you know, like Matt, you know, like in New York or at the Garden, you know, we can't go dark. You know, we can't go dark for 6 months to a year to facilitate some of these. So we have to creatively think about where are the areas that we can connect with and dive into that aren't going to directly affect. They all have a direct effect, but not directly affect the bowl or the ice sheet itself. Moving around the offices, the existing offices, two floors, meeting rooms. You know, we're blessed. We're only going up three floors. We're wide open after that, so we have an opportunity to really rethink that area. You know, we know that there are ticket offices woven in there. There's the Sports Hall of Fame, Visitor Center, but we think all those areas can be kind of rethinked and repositioned throughout the facility to better serve them and be better utilized than what they are today. And then the other large piece that we've broken down and looked at is their rehearsal hall. So, you know, spent a lot of time just, you know, high level thinking about the rehearsal hall, saying, okay, you know, its use within the facility is extremely important. But, you know, looking at the positioning, looking at the future, you know, let's just step back for once and challenge it and say, okay, what if we came in at the main level and from main level up, you know, we rethought how that was articulated and what the opportunities were for that, knowing that below that, you know, that on the event level, that space is of critical demand for, you know, SEC and other events. You know, they're utilizing that space, so we know we need that open floor print plate to stay on the event level. So what does that mean? Fifth and Broadway today, standing outside of Tootsie's, looking back across the street. You know, to our right, the old convention center. I know that's evolving with some opportunities. So this is actually standing up on the patio looking back, saying, okay, you know, what can we be tomorrow? I think a couple key things that are important to note, you know, keeping the tower intact. But now with this image, you'll see we're able to utilize the tower as a vertical circulation core, and it's getting us up actually to the upper concourse level. So the two elements that are kind of poking out to the edges of the curb are directly connected back to the upper concourse. So in theory, we have been able to push the upper concourse out, probably the tightest concourse of the building that's public. The suite concourses obviously are tight, but they're, the traffic patterns are much smaller. So we're able to push out. We're able to increase amenities, double amenities. We're able to create new fan engagement opportunities. The other thing that we're doing on this side of the building is we're studying the opportunity above the top row of seating, which would be, this will be opposite stage end, so we'll be able to activate it, hopefully for almost every event, is a new, we're weaving in between the upper structure above, again, the upper deck, weaving in a new platform that would be ideally for that younger generation, standing platform, creating a new and different kind of viewing experience and opportunity. And those patrons would also have access to this upper concourse, which would be new bars, new amenities. The other nice thing about this is that through the tower, not only can you access this from inside during an event, but you would be able to access these upper concourse amenities on a non-game day as well. In the background, you see the study for a new tower, as Sean mentioned, and the engagements that that has, how everything that we've done too as we study this, we want to make sure, I think it's important to say that everything relates back to a concourse floor. It's important that we're able to pull out from our existing concourse, but also utilize them one way on a game, on a non-game day or a non-event day from the exterior side, but during a game day, we're able to kind of rethink them and push them out to the perimeter. Below, going up Broadway from 5th to 6th, you see, again, the tower. You see some tertiary space there that's connected to the upper concourse. That would be meeting space, ballroom space, activity space that would support, again, the arena, but then also the tower. And then below that is retail. You know, looking at what is being conceived and looked at for across the street at the old convention center site, you know, we're pulling off of that, creating opportunities. This would be where the new visitor center would be woven in there, the new retail store. So, you know, one thing that we did is we pulled the retail store out in the last couple of years to the perimeter. We would now take that one step forward and move that over to Broadway in this new retail hub, which we think would be even more powerful. Moving on, standing kind of at the corner of 6th and Broadway and up on the roof as it sits today. So tomorrow, you know, this is, we talked, I was just mentioning indoor-outdoor space. So we're actually able with these adjustments and pushing out to create an outdoor terrace that is directly related back to the upper concourse. So you see the glass line on the right, it'd be a reskinning. So fans, patrons would be able to navigate across bridges from the upper concourse to this outdoor space. To the left, if you can imagine, these are, you know, rentable spaces for meetings, looking down on Broadway, looking back towards lower Broadway. But you know, you're renting them out before a game or before an event, having a pre-function in there, then making your way back over to the facility. From an aerial shot, just you start to see some of the transformations at the corner and around the building as a whole. One thing that's nice is we've been able to, with the pushing and rework of the upper concourse, we're actually creating a large canopy over the entrance plaza, which starts to create opportunities for other uses year-round for the plaza that, you know, because of the open lid, aren't always achievable today. Fifth and Demumbrian, you know, we often have referred to this lovingly as the concrete canyon. A lot of concrete moving up towards Broadway, but Fifth, you know, amazing opportunities here, especially with the new convention center, everything that has been done just in terms of bars and indoor-outdoor experiences down to the Omni. So how do we pull off of that great work? How do we support it? So this is one idea for how we think we can do that. You know, really taking the barrel as it sits today, the rehearsal hall, and kind of breaking that out, dissecting it a bit. So what you see here is we have, you know, pretty steep grades at the corner. So we're working with those, being able to, we're actually pushing the footprint of the building in a bit in this instance to create some outdoor space, which we think is really needed at the corner to soften it a bit, a little more inviting. And then within there is now two stories of commercial hospitality space. And the nice thing about it is, in essence, we are pulling the main concourse out to this edge, while at the same time creating new, you know, opportunities for engagement year-round, so this corner is always active and with something always going on. The other thing that we would pull down towards this corner is the ticket windows. You know, that's one when the ticket office, box office, was created 20 years ago, the demands of a box office were, you know, extremely different. So with technology, just with the way tickets are delivered today, those needs have changed. We think, we know that we need to get it outside the building. That's one of the struggles with it. But we also think pulling it down to this corner makes a lot of sense, has opportunity, and starts to, again, create new positionings for the corner. Moving up from this corner, one of the things we talked about was, you know, egress in and out of the building. So here is where we've started to work with and started to dissect the vertical circulation as well as the entry points. What you'll see here is that where it says restaurant, that's really today about the entrance into the facility. So we've actually, with the rework of the parking garage structure, we've been able to shift it down, almost double it in width, shift it down, make it more better positioned with the main concourse, and then meet the demands that we see in terms of traffic patterns in the future. Again, up above, you know, we've talked about ballroom space, meeting room space. So this is where we think we could start to take advantage of square footage to support not only the needs, internal needs of the facility and how it's used today and how it will be used tomorrow, but then also to support some of the needs of the convention center across the street. So now we're repositioning that meeting space directly adjacent to those. We've also studied at a high level up here, could we put an ice sheet? You know, the answer is, you know, adding that layer starts to create, and again, this layer is directly connected to the upper concourse, so also allows for that expansion space. But we do think at this end, we have the real estate necessary to put a small NHL size practice rink, which then, you know, when we start to think about those things, we see the impact that it has back on the event level and the types of space it would create on the event level for uses that are needed down there. This aerial taken from the Hall of Fame, you start to see, you know, kind of the impact it would have on the skyline, the interest that it could bring to that corner, and the activation that it would have. And then finally, jumping up to sixth, you know, the parking garage today, we think with the tower on the opposite end, you know, the repositioning of the offices obviously is necessary. So, you know, before we just said, hey, let's pluck them on this corner, we stepped back and thought about a couple of things. Number one, it was meeting space. Where is the best place to put it? But also, where is the best place to put the offices that, again, can truly now give them the front door that they deserve? And so we think this corner does it. What's nice about it is you see there and the gold at the base, you'd have a new front door in. Above there, you'd be able to go up to the second floor, which would be meeting space. Above there would be flexible space for pushing of the concourse, for public opportunities, you know, ice sheet studies, those types of elements. And above that, then you see in the background is three new additional floors of office space. So the Predators, the staff here at the Bridgestone Arena would be utilizing those, but they would also then be able to meet a guest or meet us down on the second floor. And that's where all the conference rooms in theory could be held. Also weaving back down, looking at the grade back on fifth, you start to see two more levels of commercial hospitality space. And again, the top floor would be connected back to the main concourse, which, you know, back to one of our initial points, helps to rethink toilets, concessions back on the main concourse and really improve those strategies. So, talking quickly in a nutshell, that's where we are. I think it's very exciting. I think what we have determined through the initial studies is that there is a lot of opportunity on this site. And that's what we wanted, I think, above anything else, was to just prove to ourselves, to everyone, that, you know, if we step back and take the blinders off, you know, there's a lot of ways to kind of reinvigorate and continue to elevate the facility.
And real fast, what we were challenged with 6 months ago, or 6 years ago really, was how do we improve the building? How do we make the building perform better? Blowing out the concourses, adding point of sale, adding ingress, egress, changing how people use the building. More importantly, to better speak to the surrounding areas. So what do we need? We need another tower. What will the tower be? Who knows in 5, 10, 15 years where it's there. But to create that tower, you gotta recreate the offices, you gotta recreate the meeting rooms we already have. How do you better purpose those? If we build the training center on top of the garage, it frees up the hospitality space, which is greatly needed for the CMAs, CMTs, SECs, Women's Final Four, you know, all the things that, you know, we continue to churn out. And when you start looking at the four corners of the building and blowing it out, I think we can start achieving it. But the next step is more thinking, more conversations, and really probably an engineering study that ideally will kick off in a month or two after we, you know, take some questions, continue conversations, where we really do an MEP study of, now the building's 20 years old, what will naturally wear out within the 30-year period of time, or 20 years or 40 years. So as we start bringing this to life, what do we need to start replacing? What has to be incorporated into any new renovations? And that would probably take 3 or 4 months to do that. And then we can really start having the conversation, okay, this is what we're gonna do, or here are the pieces we're gonna do, or this is the first domino, who knows where the last one will be, and then we can start bringing it about. From a funding standpoint, which should be a natural question, is, you know, this is gonna cost $10 million, or $600 million, or $400 million, or $200. It really depends on what we end up doing, but at the same time, by building on some of these new assets, these should help fund and bring about the necessary renovations requirements to keep this building flowing the way it is right now. So ideally, it'll continue on the same path that we set in motion 6 years ago and really won't have an impact on general funds. And again, other cities, other teams are having the conversations now saying, how do we replace our 20-year-old building in 5 years, 10 years, 15 years? Miami, Orlando, Charlotte, all replace their buildings within 20 years of opening. That is dumb. I mean, if they're listening, tell them this is the dumbest thing they could have done, because why would you double, you know, your investment in a building that should last a lot longer if you take care of it and you play with it properly? So this is where we are. I want to thank you guys for pushing us to do this 6-7 months ago. And I think over the next 3 or 4 months, we're going to be pretty busy doing these next steps. So if you have any questions, I'd love to answer them. But I know we did a really good job of keeping it brief. But it really is hard to keep it brief when you talk about $500 million and a $500 million annual economic impact to keep the engine going. But again, Emmett, Monica, just for some
thank you.
Out working
thank
with
you.
Us. Want to do a commercial?
No, I'm good. Thanks, guys.
Thanks.
I was just wondering if we could maybe, after we get this and read it, we could just make sure at our next meeting that we have some time set aside just to discuss the proposal and do that. Yes. So if we, I think it'd be great if we could do that and just put it on our agenda for next month. Not to stop any questions, but I'd like to have a full discussion if we could. It's great, by the way. Enjoy the presentation.
Thank you. Unless there are any questions, we will hold further dialogue until our next meeting after we have an opportunity to review the report. And at this time, we will continue to hear from Bridgestone Arena for another very brief presentation and update. Thank you.
Just a note, you realize Sean Henry hasn't spoken at a meeting in quite some time. This happens to be the longest meeting we've had in quite some time. So a little correlation there, I believe. So.
You're going to be roasted every month, right?
I know we're running late on time, but I actually really wanted to, it's the end of our fiscal year, so I wanted to go a
Kyle,
deep, yes.
Will you introduce yourself?
I will. I'm Kyle Clayton. I am the Senior Director of Business Operations for the Bridgestone Arena Nashville Predators. So usually I come up here and I talk about the financials and everything, but it's the end of our fiscal year, so I really wanted to do a deep dive, give you a hour-long presentation of how we've done this year, but running late on time. And actually our audit starts next month, so these are all pre-audited financials for the year, so we'll kind of fly through them pretty quick because we'll update them as we finalize everything. But as we report all year long, our revenues soared this year. We actually ended up higher than last year. We surpassed $12.5 million. So that's the highest we've done at Bridgestone Arena. So it's 4% above last year, which is fantastic. Main drivers in that are obviously event driven. So rent revenues, food and beverage, box office revenues, things like that. It's just fantastic to reach those levels. As we go through the year, obviously, expenses get higher as you do more events. So as our expenses grew, we actually managed those quite well. And as I was talking to Margaret before the meeting, what we did was as we're projecting into June, we realized kind of a budget surplus that we had. And what we decided to do instead of, as our lease allows us, we can take that savings, if you will, and keep it as profit as ourselves. But what we decided to do is forego that financial gain and invest it back into the building. That's something that we show our commitment to where we want to be here at 501 Broadway and keep ever evolving this building and keep it top notch. And we want to be the Madison Square Gardens. We want to be the Staples Centers. We want to keep this building up into shape. And so we've talked about all year long this $500,000 investment, which is restrooms and lighting upgrades and things like that. So as we got into June, we realized we had about another $200,000 to $300,000 that we could put back into the building. So we made that decision to do that. And so mostly those improvements are mechanical upgrades, some machine type items, some servicing. And then also we purchased a new ice deck covering for the floor, which is better insulation, it's easier to move, you can change over crews, can do everything a lot faster. So it just improves the overall efficiency of the entire building. It really makes us even more dynamic than we already are. So those are exciting things. I know Tim Friedenberger back there is so excited when we awarded him that money to do that, because he's been preaching that we need a new floor for quite some time. So I know he was very excited about that. Just to hit on June events real quick, we had the CMT Awards, which is a great national broadcast. Really highlights our city and what we do here. It's just a great partnership with those guys every year, put on that great show. We also had Selena Gomez, Justin Bieber, that was a big event, and then also Slipknot. On the team side, going through pretty quick, I don't know, we've talked about it a million times, but we're gonna keep harping on it. The biggest trade in franchise history, brought in PK Subban. We're all so excited to get this season started. The schedule is also announced in June, so we actually opened the regular season October 14th at home against Chicago, so. It's going to be a loud, great gold night in this building. We're so excited to get PK in here and get him playing and show the world what Nashville can do. We also signed Philip Forsberg to a long-term deal. Again, we're solidifying that core of what the Predators are and showing that players want to be here, and we can have success on the ice along with the building and everybody together. We also had the NHL draft. Development camp was hosted, so a lot of things going on the team side during the summer, so that's always great. We'd like to recognize people that on our staff that win awards. We talked about Ben Bossy last month and Chad Lucky in our security department. It's always great when you talk about somebody that's done something in the community. So our Senior Director of Community Relations and Executive Director of the Predators Foundation, Rebecca King, she presented to you guys, I think, 2 or 3 months ago down in the Lexus Lounge about all the things going on with our foundation. Well, she actually won Nashville's Emerging Leaders Award, which recognizes professionals under 40 who have made significant accomplishments in their field and contributions to the community. So it's a great honor for her, and we're very excited to be part of that. And what she does to this community is just, it's outstanding. Real quick on Ford Ice, we had a couple tournaments in June. We had the Honky Tonk Showdown. That was a lot of fun. We had a lot of summer camps going on. Scott Hamilton's doing his thing out there. It's going great. Year-over-year results, we'll do a kind of a year-end recap coming up once we get some more numbers finalized, but obviously everything, as we've preached all year long, is up. And then our summer leagues are starting, but just to highlight our summer adult leagues, we're tapped out. We had 50 teams and over 700 participants in that adult league. So, you know, the youth and everything's growing tremendously, but just to highlight the adults and how much hockey is such a vibrant market here in Nashville and how that just continues to grow. And we're trying to cultivate all that out at Fordyce. So I'll bring up David Kells here in a second to talk about future and everything else that's going on, renovations and whatnot. But any questions on June or the financials or anything like that for me?
I assume everybody knows I'm going to say something. But anyway, Kyle, I just want to point out, and you alluded to our conversation earlier, but in the third paragraph of your report for financials to our executive director, you do point out the Predators' contributions that you've made that made the expenses go up a little bit. But I just want to thank the Predators for doing that and knowing that was an opportunity with the surplus. It was a great year with a record year in revenues. But I do appreciate, too, the contribution that the organization made at that juncture. Thank you.
Absolutely. I mean, we're a partner in this whole deal, and we want to make this arena the number one sports entertainment venue in North America, and that's what we're striving to do every day, and financial commitments are a part of that, and that's what we strive for. Perfect. Thank you. Mr. Kells.
Hi there, I'm David Kells, Senior Vice President of Booking for Bridgestone Arena and the Nashville Predators. As Kyle alluded to, I'll kind of talk about what we have going on currently and going forward. Since our last meeting, we have hosted 5 Seconds of Summer, the week-long Beachbody Conference, WWE, Jim Gaffigan, and last night's Dixie Chicks show. Last night, our crew came in, stripped out all the Dixie Chicks stuff. Now we've got dirt coming in for bull riding. We'll have 2 nights of that starting tomorrow night. We've also been very fortunate. We announced that Eric Church is going to do 2 shows here. Those shows will be May 26th and 27th of next year, and we hope to announce that on sale here shortly. Also, since our last meeting, we put Casting Crowns on sale. They come here every couple of years and always put on a great show. That'll be November 18th. And in the next few weeks, just looking at our calendar, I think we're going to have 6 more major concert announcements and on sales in the next couple of weeks, so we're excited about all that stuff. And this summer, you know, we are doing a lot of improvements as we do every year. We're very happy that the 200 and 300 level seat install finished up last week. We were able to manage that in-house with Tim Friedenberger and all of those staff. We came in under budget and on time, so we were thrilled with all of that. And from the start of the project in early May, we were able to host 11 concerts, the CMT Awards, and 2 week-long conferences without any interruption in the schedule. So we had crews working overnights, or if they knew there was a 3-day gap, they would bring in as much staff as they could, hit it hard then, and then get back out. So we never missed a beat, never had a seat we couldn't sell, and that's due largely in part to what Tim Friedenberger and our in-house staff was able to manage and knock out this summer. And we're also in the middle of some more bathroom renovations. Last year, I believe we did 16. This year, we're adding an additional 10 just to keep those up to date, upgraded, and making them look nice for all the guests coming through. And also, like last year, we're about to start another batch of concession stand improvements. Last year, you'll remember, we reskinned everything and did a lot of infrastructure to the majority of them. But there's a couple outliers that we can attack this year. And so we're going to start knocking that out in the next couple of weeks. That's all I have. Any other questions? I'm making up for the time that others used. So.
Thank you.
Thanks, y'all.
Doug Scopel, First Tennessee Report.
Good morning, everyone. We'll keep this short and sweet. With me today, I've got Adam Noose, our general manager, who you guys have met. He's been with us for 2 or 3 months. Since our last meeting, we've hired a new vice president of sales, Brian Mayhood, who is right here. Exciting addition for us. Both of those guys bring in a lot of energy, great experience. And, you know, we're only in year 2 of the new ballpark for the Sounds, but always trying to improve the fan experience, the ballpark experience. And even though we still have a little bit of baseball season left for this year, they're already hard at work, all of us are, but them specifically, on reaching out, connecting with fans. Those of you that have been out to the game hopefully have met with them, talked to them. If you haven't, you will soon. Just really excited about getting some good, continued positive momentum moving forward for the Sounds. Sounds are having a great year on the field. First place team, as I've mentioned pretty much all year. Magic number to clinch a playoff berth is down to 9. The Sounds haven't made the playoffs in 10 years, so we're excited about hopefully having some baseball in September. 6 home games left for us, including tonight and tomorrow, for regular season, and then we could host anywhere from 1 to 6 playoff games, depending on how those series go. So we're really excited about that. And somehow our manager, Steve Scarsone, continues to make this work with a patchwork roster. Makes it sound like we don't have good players. We have really good players, but we've had the Oakland A's, our major league affiliate, has set a new record this year for number of players put on the disabled list. And when that happens, they take guys from AAA. So we've already had 20 different players go up to the big leagues, and we continue to win. Half of the A's current roster in the big leagues are guys that spent 2-3 months with us already this year. So it's just incredible showing up the A's system. And then behind us, you know, the Sounds are going to make the playoffs. The Double-A team in Midland, Texas are also going to make their playoffs. So just real good depth in this system. We're excited about that. You know, we can't necessarily control that part of it, but it's a nice added benefit to all the fan experience stuff that we do out there. From the business side, another real good year. We're pacing right on where we were last year in the first year of the ballpark from an attendance standpoint. We just welcomed our 1 millionth fan in ballpark history. It's always good to have those milestone numbers out there. Community side, I mentioned last month, we completed the building of the new playground for the Buena Vista Elementary School right in our neighborhood. We had the grand opening of that on August 11th when they did their school open house. I think they had every teacher there and a bunch of kids, and it was really cool to see the excitement on their faces just to have a new fun place to play. And we continue to look forward to work with them and other local partners to become a part of our new community. We've had a few different events at the ballpark. Rascal Flatts was out celebrating a number one hit party there. Cole Swindell, an up-and-coming country star, shot part of his latest music video during a game, which was pretty cool. And right before the Olympics, Comcast hosted with the Sports Council, Sean Johnson, the former Olympic gold medal gymnast, out for a luncheon or breakfast to talk about the Olympics. Coming up, in addition to Sounds, hopefully playoff games, we've got a repeat of a beer festival we did last year, Drink, Eat, Play, where we bring a bunch of food trucks in. It was successful in year one, and I look forward to make that bigger and better. And as part of our continued partnership with Albert Pujols, the future Hall of Famer, his family foundation is based here in Tennessee. His wife has her ties here. Those of you may remember, he was a part of the groundbreaking of First Tennessee Park a couple years ago. He's a great ambassador for baseball, obviously. We want to partner with him and anybody that wants to promote baseball. But we're going to host at the ballpark in early October a charity home run derby with his group. So just another way to get some youth out involved, see the ballpark, continue the love of the game of the baseball. One other quick note on the Sounds. About a week and a half ago, one of our pitchers came within one out of throwing a perfect game, which that just to give you some reference on how rare occurrence that is, our league has 114-year history. There have only been 3 9-inning perfect games, and he was down to the last batter, and the guy just got a ball that just missed our left fielder's glove. So his name's Jarrell Cotton. He was a prospect they picked up from the Dodgers in a trade at the deadline, but that would have been really cool. He finished with a one-hit shutout, which I'm making sound like isn't great, but that's really fantastic too. So just a lot of good fun stuff happening out at the ballpark. Hopefully we see you guys out there in the next 2 or 3 weeks as we wrap it up. Any questions?
Thank you, Doug. Any questions? Oh, Chuck.
Madam Chairman, I would just like to take this opportunity. I've had the opportunity to thank Doug and the Sounds organization for the honor you gave me of naming the umpire room after me. And I just want to say in front of the board, it was really a nice honor, and I really appreciate it. And thank you very much.
Very deserved.
Thank you. I believe that's the bulk of our agenda. I just want to note our next meeting is September 15th, and at that time we will have the board will have a visit from Metro HR. They're going to provide a diversity and sexual harassment training. We're planning to do that at the conclusion of the board meeting to best accommodate everyone's time. That training is required for all boards and commissions. So if any board member has a conflict and will not be able to stick around for that, please let Monica know as soon as you can so we can make other arrangements. Other than that, I believe that concludes our agenda today. Is there any other business? All right. At this time, we'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
So moved. Moved and seconded. All right. Thank you. We are adjourned. Thank you.